So, if you're here, then I have a feeling that you might have checked out a lot of my other videos that I've done based on Ransom and the Queen. I have been pumping them out, and that's because I was the one who wrote the study guide for these two texts. So I just wanted to share all my knowledge with you. I'll make sure to link all of those videos for you in the description box below, so you can make sure you tick each one of them off as you're studying for Ransom and the Queen. But for today, we're going to be talking about historical context and why it is important. You'll see in a lot of study guides out there that they often start with a historical context section. Even though it might be tempting to skip over this section, there's actually a lot you can take away from understanding the period of time in which your texts are set in. I'll show you how with examples from Ransom and the Queen in this video. Let's start off with a brief overview of why you need to know historical context. Context, a topic explored in my How to Write a Killer Text Response ebook, plummets you back into the era your texts were set in. You effectively step into the shoes of the people living in that time, and in doing so, gain a better understanding of their views and values, which we've talked about on this channel before. People's views and values are often shaped by important events of the time, social, culture, and norms, and everyday experiences. Take you and I for example. Let's have a think about our own context in today's time. You're part of Generation Z, and one defining part of the Gen Z experience is growing up with technology from a young age. Social media is just a normality. Pretty much everyone has it, uses it, and is a source of online communication. So, how does this shape your views and values though? By having access to online information in this way, Gen Zers tend to be more passionate about social issues because people of this age can leverage social media to voice their opinions or follow those who resonate with them. Only 20 years or so ago, we really only had giant media that voiced their own opinions via newspapers or TV. You didn't really have such a wide array of voices from different people, different races, ages, and experiences. Think about the recent death of George Floyd and the incredible ripple effect his death had on the world and the power of social media in the Black Lives Matter movement. So looking back now at Ransom and the Queen, we want to dive into their respective eras and understand how people thought and felt during this period. This helps us better understand the messages Frears and Maloof are trying to tell or teach us through their works, enabling you to write better essays. Let's start with the Queen. The 1980s to 1990s was a time when the world was enamored by the Princess of Wales, or Diana as we'll call her. Her shyness, broken family history, ongoing charitable efforts, and iconic fashion choices made her a royal favorite. She was dubbed People's Princess, not only because of her relatability, but also because of her tenuous relationship with the royal family. She'd been wronged by the royal family, first by Prince Charles's affair with Camilla, then with the lack of support from the Queen when she asked for marriage advice. At the time, public opinion of the royal family was greatly influenced by tabloid papers. After all, there was no Instagram for the royals to tell their own story. After an estimated 750 million people tuned in to watch Diana's wedding to Charles, paparazzi began documenting her every move. Princess Diana became the most photographed person in the world, with paparazzi offered up to £500,000 for even grainy pictures of her. That's equivalent to 1.5 million AUD today. In the competitive fight to snap the most profitable photos of Diana, the paparazzi invaded her most private moments, taking shots of her kissing dirty Al-Fayed while on holidays and sunbathing topless at her hotel in Spain. Diana's despair and request to be left alone remained unanswered. So when the paparazzi chased her to her death in 1997, the public response was emphatic. The public turned against Britain's press and photographers, and the overwhelming outpour of grief is a testament to the injustice the public felt on behalf of Diana. To add insult to injury, the monarchy's initial reticent response was deemed inadequate, negatively shifting the public's attitude or mood, a term we often hear in the film, towards the royals. It's essential for the monarchy to stay in the public's favor, lest the end of the institution. That's why The Queen is a film about change on several fronts. First, the dynamic response from the public, the Queen abandoning royal tradition and acquiescing to public demand, and how this happens within months of Tony Blair's new premiership. With this knowledge, you can understand why change is one of the biggest themes discussed when comparing these two texts. Let's look at Ransom. Moving back a further 3,000 years earlier than The Queen, Ransom is a retelling of the Trojan War, one of the most famous events in Greek mythology. To truly understand Ransom, you must firstly familiarize yourself with Greek mythology, the Trojan War, and the Iliad. We'll have a look at these three as if they're babushka dolls, where dolls of decreasing size are placed inside one another. We'll start with the biggest doll, Greek mythology. We're starting with Greek mythology because it's the umbrella knowledge you need to know before being able to understand the Trojan War and the Iliad. Essentially a collection of stories about gods, heroes, and other cultures, Greek mythology was used by ancient Greeks to explain the existence of the world. Without the scientific developments discovered to date, ancient Greeks attempted to explain the creation of Earth, human behavior, death, and love through their mythical stories. Notice how the gods, Iris and Hermes, appear when Priam needs help and advice throughout Ransom. The reason why Greek mythology is still prevalent in modern society is because the lessons taught in these stories are still applicable today as they depict universal truths about human qualities, such as our strengths and flaws. Without you even realizing it, our world today is filled with references to Greek mythology. Take for example, Pandora, whose namesake comes from the myth about Pandora's box. Or take the first God of War game, which follows the story of Kratos, whose ability to be a loving father is overpowered by his anger and desire for vengeance. Luckily for you, you don't have to know all Greek mythology, but you do need to know one of them, the Trojan War. And with that, we enter into our second babushka doll. This war will be especially familiar to you because it's the backdrop and context of Ransom. The myth begins with Zeus, the father of all gods, and his brother Poseidon lusting after the goddess of water, Thetis. However, they're warned by Prometheus, an intelligent mortal, better known for being chained to a rock as a result of stealing Zeus's fire, that Thetis would give birth to a son who would be mightier than his father. Alarmed at this possibility, the two gods arrange for Thetis to marry Peleus, a mortal. Since humans were believed to be inferior to gods, this ensured that Thetis's child would be a mere mortal, rendering the prophecy redundant. Any potential issues appeared resolved until the gods omitted Eris, the god of discord, from Thetis and Peleus' wedding invitation list. Furious at the insult, Eris arrives at the wedding with her own plans. She inscribes a gold apple with the words, "To the fairest," and throws it amongst the guests. Naturally, all goddesses want to claim the prize. Eventually, the choice is narrowed down to three of the most beautiful goddesses, Aphrodite, Athena, and Hera. Unable to reach a decision, they turn to Zeus to judge who should win the title. However, Zeus refuses to do so and instead elects a mortal with good judgment of beauty to make the choice. This mortal is Paris, prince of Troy, and whose birth produced a prophecy that he would one day bring misfortune to his people and town. The three goddesses approach Paris with not only their beauty, but also bribes. Hera offers him power and control over Europe and Asia. Athena promises that she will make him a great warrior, while Aphrodite proposes to him the most beautiful woman on earth. Since Paris is more interested in women than power and war, he awards Aphrodite with the golden apple. With this exchange sealed, the beginning of Troy's trouble begin as the most beautiful woman on earth, Helen, is already married to Melanus, king of Sparta. After a diplomatic mission to Sparta, Paris elopes with Helen, who falls in love with Paris upon their first encounter. Just bear in mind that literature concerning this part of the story is slightly ambiguous, but it's not too important for you as you're studying for Ransom. Upon discovering Paris's betrayal, Melanus calls on Helen's many suitors to invade Troy and retrieve his wife. His brother, Agamemnon, recruits and leads the Greek army into battle against the city of Troy, and thus begins the Trojan War. And finally, we get into the baby doll, the Iliad. Homer's The Iliad is a poem that picks up 10 years into the Trojan War. By now, Thetis, the goddess who had married Peleus, has given birth to their mortal son, Achilles, the mightiest of all Greeks, as predicted by the prophecies. Achilles should be super familiar to you because he's obviously one of the characters in Ransom. So notice how we're getting closer and closer to Maloof's Ransom now. Although he's a fighter for Agamemnon, their relationship is strained after Agamemnon demands that Achilles give up his beloved war prize, Perseus. Since Agamemnon desires Briseis for himself, this enrages Achilles to the point where he refuses to fight in the Trojan War. This leads to dire consequences for the Greeks as they lose many men in battle and are forced to retreat to their ships after the Trojans successfully turn the tide of the battle. Concerned for his Myrmidons, a group of the strongest and skilled warriors who fight for Achilles, yet too proud to budge from his position, Achilles is persuaded to allow his close friend and comrade Patroclus to wear Achilles' renowned armor and lead his Myrmidons into battle. Ah, more connections to ransom with Patroclus. This strategy is designed to rouse fear in the Trojans and cause them to temporarily retreat, enough time to allow the Greeks to rest and recover, as they'd see Achilles back in battle. Despite Patroclus' skills as a soldier, Achilles insists that Patroclus only fight until the Greeks can successfully fend off the Trojans away from their ships. During the fight, however, Patroclus obeys Achilles' orders and continues to pursue the Trojans back to their gates. At this point, he encounters and is killed by Hector, the prince of Troy and leader of the Trojan army. Fueled by rage and grief over Patroclus' death, Achilles agrees to fight once again for the Greek army, much to Agamemnon's pleasure. In the next battle, Achilles kills many warriors and the Trojans are forced to retreat to the safety of their walls. Hector, against the will of his family, faces Achilles alone outside the walls of his home, knowing that Achilles is on a path to avenge Patroclus' death. In a fierce battle between the two greatest Trojan war warriors, Hector is killed. Achilles takes Hector's body with him and dishonors it day after day by chaining it to a chariot and dragging it along the walls of Troy. Maloof begins the ransom story here. The gods agree that this blasphemous behavior cannot continue and send the god Hermes to guide Priam, father of Hector, to the Greek camp. Once in their camp, Priam falls to his knees and pleads Achilles for the body of his son. Touched by the king's words, Achilles relents, allowing Priam to finally hold a proper burial for Hector. Appreciating the storyline differences between the Iliad and Ransom will lead to better understanding of the themes and symbols in Ransom. One of the main differences between the two texts is the depiction of Priam's journey to Achilles. In the Iliad, this journey is explored only momentarily, and focuses more on the presence of Hermes. The inclusion of the new character Somax in Ransom also offers a new perspective on this old tale. While the Iliad only touches upon Achilles and Priam's suffering, Maloof delves into the emotional journey that the characters undergo during the darkest episode in the Trojan War. That's why the themes of grief, loss, and death should be quite prominent in your comparison between Ransom and the Queen, along with the importance of stories and storytelling. I know this was a long video, but hopefully you can see now how contextual knowledge really helps empower your discussion in an essay. I've just released my new study guide based on Ransom and the Queen, which I have personally written, and using the knowledge that you've learned today and in all of the other videos that I've done on Ransom and the Queen on this channel, I then move on to actually utilize these pieces of knowledge in writing A+ example essays for you. I'd highly recommend that you download a free sample to get a preview look for yourself. It's only $25, but it's the most detailed study guide that I've seen available out there, because I know there are not many resources currently available, and if they are, they don't really go into that much depth to support you in your SAC and exams. I'm going to break down a Ransom and the Queen essay topic soon, so make sure you subscribe to this channel and stay tuned. Thanks for watching, guys. Bye.